Thank you for that kind introduction and for having me back at St. Anselm's and the Institute. I come to you today as a former small businessman, a mayor, and a governor, who is worried about our economy and about society. If we listen to the president these days, you would think that we have nothing to worry about. He says our economy is going strong, but actually our economy is going wrong. Wrong for workers, wrong for new graduates, wrong for small business people, wrong for women and communities of color, and wrong for our middle class. Now, Donald Trump is a big piece of this problem. He has helped to create a crisis of division, and that's why I want to replace him. Trump is stripping affordable health care away from millions of Americans. That's just wrong. He is running up deficits and saddling our children with debt so we can give tax cuts to America's largest corporations and wealthiest individuals. That's wrong. He is assaulting laws and programs that were designed to protect workers, unions, consumers, students, our sense of justice, and the health of our planet. And that is all terribly wrong. And I haven't even gotten to common decency. But the problems with our economy are bigger than Donald Trump. They predate Trump, and if we don't act, they will outlast him. Getting rid of Donald Trump is necessary. Indeed, I believe it's absolutely essential, but it is not sufficient. And unless our next president takes office with a new plan, a bold plan, to reboot American capitalism, to ensure both economic justice and economic growth, then the same forces of division that opened the door for Trump will bring us more dangerous demagogues in the future. Now here's the central problem. For too long, too many of our leaders have let America's policies drift away from what I think most of us believe are our core values, especially the value we place on American workers and the work they do. At times, our leaders were passive in the faces of big forces like globalization and automation, leaving workers to fall behind and be left behind. For decades, economic policies have shifted to favor the wealthy and powerful over those who work hard to get by. Consider, in the two generations after World War II, inflation adjusted, America's wealth per person doubled. And it wasn't just GDP or the wealth of the wealthy. The wealth of average families doubled. By the end of the 1970s and in 1980, that changed. After the oil shocks hit and Republican trickle-down policies came on, our economy stopped driving middle-class prosperity. Since then, real wages, inflation adjusted, have hardly grown at all. It's fair to say that for almost half the population, there's been almost no gain. Gains in income and wealth have gone almost entirely to the top 1% of Americans. Now we have this hourglass economy with a few at the top with sky-high incomes, a hollowed-out middle, and large numbers stuck at the bottom. And this hourglass is telling us that we're running out of time. No democracy in human history has survived this kind, this level, this magnitude of inequality, such as we're experiencing today. Now, you know, if you step back, you've really got to hand it to the GOP for achieving the near impossible. Just years after the collapse of the Soviet Union, their greed and mismanagement has revived the lure of socialism for a whole generation of Americans. Who would have imagined the Koch brothers and Donald Trump could help resuscitate the discredited ideas of Karl Marx and Joseph Stalin? Socialism is no better a solution today than it was 100 years ago. The answers to our current economic problems are not simple, but they are not socialism. As an entrepreneur, as a proud entrepreneur, I am convinced that the answer starts with reestablishing the primacy of one core value above all, work. The centrality of the workers and farmers and innovators who are at America's foundation. We need to ensure stronger rights to the human capital we each own in our time. And this includes our work, our ideas, even our privacy. When capitalism works, we should all have money left over after paying our bills. That is, that is capital. Money that enables us to invest, be that in our skills, our children, our future. Literally, whatever we choose. In this country, that is one of our most sacred liberties. From the earliest days of the Republic, we built an economy and social fabric centered on the idea of work and enterprise. From John Henry to Rosie the Riveter, from farms to our mills to the garages where American entrepreneurs invented the computer age. The importance of work isn't just an abstract concept for me. And it over the years, it has only gotten more personal. I first moved out to Colorado in the early 1980s as a geologist. And then a recession hit, as they always do, despite what our president promises. And I lost not only my job, I lost my profession. Over 10,000 geologists were laid off. I was out of work for 2 years, and I was fortunate that I didn't have the responsibilities of a wife or children, but still, when you're unemployed that long, you begin to see a different person in the mirror. You begin to question your purpose. But then some friends and I checked out the proverbial book from the library about how to write a business plan. I didn't know what the words pro forma meant. And 20 and 34 investors, and 3 loans later, we opened this new concept, a brew pub, a restaurant that brews its own beer in an abandoned part of Denver. The rent was $1 a square foot per year. After a few years of 70-hour weeks, the brewery took off. An entire neighborhood grew up around it. Of all the people running for 2020, there are only a few who have had the experience of creating jobs, really creating jobs. And I think only one who has had the experience of creating jobs both in the private and the public sector. When I became mayor and then governor, I insisted on putting work and workers and entrepreneurship at the center of our strategy. And I think the results were dramatic. We funded scholarships for low-income students. We invested in apprenticeships and training so young people could get cutting-edge skills. We created a job matching program, skillful.com, so workers could see how to plug into the new economy. We pulled together mayors from the entire Metro Denver area, most of them Republicans, and launched a huge expansion of light rail, and so much more. As a result, as you heard in the introduction, Colorado went from 40th in job growth to being the number one economy in the country for the past 2 years, according to US News and World Report. Let me tell you a couple things we didn't do. First, we didn't demonize the private sector to try and score political points. And maybe that works when you're an office holder in Washington. I don't want to cast aspersions. When you're an office holder in Washington where your ideas really just have to win the next election. But when you're a mayor or a governor or a CEO, your ideas have to get results. You're where the proverbial buck has to stop. That's why we worked with business leaders to build our apprenticeship program and our training programs and our scholarship programs and indeed our light rail system. It's why we believe so strongly in public-private partnerships. The second thing we didn't do, we never went about trying to help working people in ways that could undermine our long-term economic health. That's another delusion of some folks in Washington, to try to simply redistribute our economic bounty without growing our bounty is a fool's errand, and one that will surely lead to calamity and unintended consequences. When the economy doesn't grow, working people are always the first to suffer. In Colorado, we actually went out and got rid of thousands of government regulations, unnecessary red tape, to help motivate more entrepreneurs to start more businesses. Sometimes spurring growth requires government action, but sometimes it requires getting rid of that excessive growth that happens in any enterprise, and also that part of government I often refer to as the fundamental nonsense of government. Let me be blunt about one thing. Some of the policies being proposed this year, I think, would be hazardous to our economy and our people. A total government takeover of all health insurance, a federal job guarantee for every person in America. These are certainly big ideas, but they are also quite possibly very bad ideas. I think they would bloat federal government and massively raise taxes. They would depress economic growth. And let me assure you that in the end, they would hurt working people. I'm running for president so we can have an economy defined by both justice and growth. The answer isn't to embrace socialism, but rather to reboot and rescue American capitalism and make it what it should be and what it can be, a force to better lives for everyone and create a more just society. Above all, I'm running to put workers and entrepreneurs at the center of our economic life. That means putting the dominant focus of our policies on workers, their skills, their job opportunities, their ability to adapt to economic change, and their ability to create a good life. Today, we are unveiling our national strategy for a working America. It is a strategy for reducing economic inequality, but also for growing the economy. Here are some of the basics. Quality of life starts with a good job. People need rewarding work. We'll start by making sure that work pays, by raising the minimum wage over a period of time to at least $15 an hour. We'll put more teeth into pay equity to ensure that men and women who do equal work receive equal pay. And we'll make labor unions real partners in our strategy, because when unions are strong, America's middle class is strong. But the heart of our strategy consists of six parts. First, we'll start by making college more affordable for young people, by enabling students to refinance their loans at low rates, and by strengthening provisions so that graduates can work off student loan debt, if they take jobs in teaching or other forms of public service. And we also need to make sure our young people have the skills for tomorrow's economy. While it's important to make universities affordable, two of every three young people never get a four-year degree. These kids should really be our starting point. It's time to make sure this forgotten two-thirds has access to training and skills so that they get good jobs and the country gets strong growth. That's why we're going to launch the largest expansion of apprenticeships and training in American history, so our young people are ready for the jobs of the future. And let me assure you, those jobs are coming. I'll make sure they have the skills where things like automation and artificial intelligence become career opportunities rather than career killers. We will make community college free for those who can't afford it, and take the career-wise apprenticeship model we pioneered in Colorado and scale it nationwide. Second, we will generate millions of new good jobs by repairing America's crumbling roads and bridges and ports and building thousands of clean energy projects. That's what we did in Colorado. In addition to Fast Tracks, the largest transit initiative in modern American history, we provided incentives for clean energy jobs across the state. And today, Colorado has as many jobs in clean energy as in mineral extraction. As Amory Lovins and many others have argued, a smart, market-friendly program of clean energy development can help transform climate change from an economic threat into an economic opportunity across America. We will also build the infrastructure rural America needs most, high-speed broadband in every county in the country, as we are already doing in Colorado. We'll have broadband in every city in Colorado by the end of 2020. Washington has been talking about such things for years, but never done it. You know what? While Washington was busy quibbling, in Colorado, we were doing it. And as president, I'll get it done nationwide. Third, I'll promote entrepreneurship. After being a dad, the best but also the hardest thing I ever did was to start a small business. We want to give more Americans the chance to do the same, because that's the source of the vast majority of new jobs. Today, the venture capital business in tech is going great, but in many fields, small businesses are hard-pressed. I'll create a micro-enterprise tax credit for firms with 5 employees or fewer and up to $10 million in revenue. We'll create incentives for startups in rural and distressed areas, just as we did in Colorado. And we'll strengthen antitrust enforcement so that the dominance of 3 or 4 mega players in so many industries doesn't intimidate would-be entrepreneurs away from making that final leap into starting a job, starting a business. Fourth, we'll reform our healthcare system so that we have universal coverage, a coordinated plan to limit costs, and portability. Today, too many would-be entrepreneurs are deterred from pursuing their startup dreams, and too many workers are deterred from seeking a new and better job because it could mean giving up their health care if they move. We believe that every American from the get-go should have the opportunity to pursue the work of their dreams whenever they want it, wherever they want it. We reject the idea that we can improve health care by demonizing the private sector and turning health care over to the government. Today, over 150 million Americans get private, mostly employer-provided coverage, and the majority are satisfied with it. It would be a fierce and needless battle to take that away from them. Under my plan, if you want to keep your private coverage, fine. But if you don't have coverage or you desire coverage from a public option, we'll make that available and affordable. And we'll reform the private insurance market to make sure that we bring costs under control at the same time. Now, fifth, we will change the rules of our economy to reduce inequality, eliminate corporate welfare, stop discriminating against people who work, and start rewarding workers for their effort. As president, I'll double the federal earned income tax credit and make sure it's fully available to workers without children, so the people who work full-time do not have to live in poverty. This will lift millions out of poverty and help boost economic growth because it will put more money in consumers' pockets. At the same time, we're going to close down loopholes that reward people for not working. For example, although I was a businessman, I am not convinced there are sufficient reasons why we continue to tax people less if they make their money passively through the capital gains on their stocks and dividends, but then tax them more if they bust their chops every day teaching school or paving roads or writing code. In the 20th century, we were awash in human capital, but financial capital was scarce and precious. We needed to incentivize, through tax breaks, people's investment of financial capital. In this century, if you think about it, it is almost the opposite. We are awash in financial capital, but it is the human capital that today is more precious. Our tax system should reflect this reversal. We will work with Congress to tax capital gains adjusted for inflation at the same rate as ordinary income, and end the loopholes that allow the very wealthy, when they die, to pass on their portfolios to their children tax-free. Now, we'll exempt retirement accounts, primary residences, and small businesses. America works when everyone pays their fair share, and that's the intent of the plan we've designed. Now, sixth and last, we will pursue an expansion of open and fair trade. One of the dumbest things Donald Trump did was walk away from trade agreements, however imperfect, and instead of trying to improve them, he incited tariff wars in their place. If properly improved, these trade agreements held the prospect of growing our economy, creating good jobs, and deepening our ties with key friends and allies around the world. We have to ensure trade is fair to our workers, our entrepreneurs, and our environment. But we can't do that with walls and tariffs. We need to do it with negotiations that open up the world to our products and our services. You can't grow our economy without growing trade. Anyone who isn't speaking up for open and fair trade probably isn't speaking up for American workers. Today, American capitalism has gone wrong in so many ways, but we can rescue it. We can expand economic equality and economic growth. We can make the private sector into a stronger engine of opportunity and innovation than having it continue as a political piñata. When it comes to building a stronger, more equitable economy, I am an optimist. As a small business owner, you have to be. I believe if we pursue the kinds of strategies we've outlined, or I've outlined today, we can create an economy that provides security and opportunity for all Americans, not just the top 1%. We can transform the forgotten two-thirds into the amazing two-thirds, another greatest generation with a level of skills our country hasn't imagined but desperately needs. We can end this devastating pattern of an hourglass economy and restore a big, healthy, growing, secure middle class where work is rewarded and rewarding and workers come first. At the end of my presidency, I want people to feel like America's economy is really working again, where that our country's values of hard work and hard workers are rewarded, and that for millions upon millions, the American dream is back within reach. Thank you very much. Questions? Yes.
Your economic program is well thought out and well developed. I like a lot of it. The one thing that concerns me is you're aiming at two or three or four Democrats that have socialist-sounding programs, though they don't want a socialist government. But you have forgot one of the biggest socialists of all, and that's Don John Trump. Remember that Don John declared bankruptcy 9 times. The taxpayers picked up the cost of his incompetence as a business leader. Total incompetence. The other thing he's done is the taxpayers in Brooklyn and Queens, New York, built a $127 million golf course for him, which you're probably aware of. By the way, it's a private course, built with public money. If that's not socialism, I don't know what it is. And I'm gonna talk about, be careful about attacking too many Democrats.
I haven't attacked a single Democrat.
Well, but you're
trust
not,
me, I give,
I'm
I
not
give.
Attacking you, but you did talk about socialism, and I think Bernie's idea of free college is nonsense, and most Democrats are gonna reject it. But when you're gonna talk about you don't support socialist programs, make sure you go after Trump in his fancy golf course paid by the taxpayers in his 9th.
Fair enough. So first, let me just say that Donald Trump and I separate ourselves. We both were in business. That's about the commonality that we had.
Exactly.
I started 20 businesses. I had over 250 investors. I had over 1,200 employees. I've never sued anyone. I've never been sued. No bankruptcies, and I've not declared bankruptcy. But I think that I say all the time that Senator Sanders created clarity around some of the issues that are most discussed, and before he came along, we didn't talk about student debt, and we didn't have a vision of where we want to get to in 20 years. I don't agree that we can go overnight to Medicare for all, but I don't attack him on that. And I've been very careful no matter where I am. You know, I don't know if I'm the only person in this campaign, but I've never done a negative ad. I've never tried to attack my opponents to get in the newspapers and raise myself up because that at the end of the election, all those, you're not just attacking that person, you're attacking all the people that believe in that person. And after the election, if you're gonna deal with climate change and the inflation of healthcare, we gotta all come together after the election, without question. I think that's what we've done in Colorado. That's the reason why I'm running for president. I think I can bring people together on the other side. Yeah.
Yeah, well, first of all, by the way, I'm from Wynwood, Pennsylvania.
So, oh my God.
So, and I went to Haverford for Friends School, right next to where you went to school.
Quaker, my family were Quakers 3 generations ago, but We knew Quakers all the time, and we knew that the Friends schools in Philadelphia, half the private schools are Quaker. That, it's an amazing fact. Just to, I mean, Quakers are what, 2% of the population of Philadelphia.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So you described the hourglass economic structure, which is one of the things that I'm sure has led to a lot of populism, and yet you're talking about free trade, which is going against the grain of what you have.
I said fair trade. I said fair trade a couple times, and then I said free and fair trade.
No. And I'm not criticizing you for that, but I'm just wondering, given that the populism, which springs from the economic situation we have, is deeply held, a lot of people do feel, with some justification, we have been ripped off by China with intellectual property rights being stolen and so forth, and we have large trade deficits with lots of other countries, and so maybe a lot of people are thinking, well, tariffs aren't all that bad after all, or maybe some more aggressive stance is called for, and you've of course got a lot of blue-collar jobs that have left. Yeah. So. Yeah, and I know you're trying to channel that into something positive, but isn't there something to the populism, and maybe your message doesn't quite address that?
No. I think sometimes when you've got a fever, you take one cure, and maybe it's not the right one. I'm just saying. I mean, there's no question that Russia was cheating on their agreements. There is no question that Russia was stealing intellectual property and extorting it from businesses that wanted to do business in China. They would have to. China would, the Chinese partner would have to get their intellectual property. It was egregious. But you don't come in and in 6 months start a tariff war. Tariff wars are historically failures by almost every measure. And I understand the attraction of them. I think our problem, I mean, if you can make more widgets than you need, and you're making so many widgets that your cost is quite low, and somebody else across the ocean needs those widgets desperately, and they've got something they can make much less expensively than you can, you should trade. It helps both sides. And that's the basic premise of trade. Now, the key, what we did a terrible job of in the 1980s and the 1990s, when I got laid off in 1980, I got laid off in 1986, our company got sold, everyone got laid off, and I went to the unemployment office, and they gave me a two-hour seminar, a class, on how to write my resume, and then how to write application letters to try and get another job as a geologist. There were no jobs as a geologist. Our government, it was government malpractice. That's what we did for people in the Rust Belt, for steel workers and automotive workers that, again, and probably half those jobs were lost through globalization, probably half of them were lost through automation. The malpractice, I think it was government malpractice, is we did not train them in the skills they needed. And what's going to happen with artificial intelligence and automation going future is going to be just as disruptive to the workplace, probably more so. And we've got to get out there ahead. Young people are going to, you're going to have to learn skills your whole life. The days of just deciding you're going to do this and you're going to do it for the rest of your life, I think you're going to have much more exciting lives and rewarding in that sense that you're going to have to continuously learn. But, I mean, we're going to have all these jobs, but you're going to have new skills. We've got to be able, and this is our partnership. It started with LinkedIn and the Markle Foundation, and now it's a partnership that when Microsoft acquired LinkedIn, and we're now doing it in 21 states, and it's called skillful.com. And it's rudimentary yet, but eventually it'll allow people, young people, or I say kids of all ages, throughout their life, to keep a profile of all the skills they acquire, and at any point, if it looks like their profession might be disappearing, they can click on other professions that look attractive, see what skills they have that would be applicable, what skills might be missing, and where they can get those skills. And I think it's government's job and partnering with community colleges to make those skills free. Ultimately, that skillful.com, I think, will allow us to look and see professions that might be disappearing in 4 or 5 years, and without alarming anyone, begin to approach those workers and say, hey, here's a set of skills you have. Here's a bunch of different jobs that we think are going to be emerging. We love you. You know, just two nights a week. It's free. You put in the time, but we'll make sure you have the curriculum so that you can be prepared and have choices. You make the decisions as the economy changes so you're not left behind and abandoned. And I believe that's a large part of why so many people voted for Donald Trump, was that they felt that the American government, the American people, didn't care about them.
We've got to end it now, but you're going to stick around for a few minutes.
Sure.
A few questions on the left.
Great. Thank you all for being here. I appreciate you coming.